Hello, friends. Welcome back to your new community. We're continuing on in our study of Paul's letter to the Christians in Ephesus. We've called the series The Church, Christ's Beloved Passion. Our hope and prayer is that we would just learn more deeply of our unity in Christ and just the deepest root of our unity. Before we get into today's passage, just a quick preview of a mini Advent series that we will begin this Sunday. We'll take a break from Ephesians for around 4 to 6 weeks beginning this Sunday, and we'll begin a little mini series entitled Rejoice, Finding Christmas Joy in the Fulfillment of God's Sure Promises. And we're going to look at four Old Testament passages for starters that look forward to Jesus's first advent. This past Sunday, did my best to unpack the church's mission and four qualities of Christian mission from Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. And I sought to sort of challenge our thinking with this thought: there is a lostness more dire than even a missing child on earth, referring to just a real life sad story, a current story of a missing child. And there is a heavenly father searching for and longing to rescue his child more passionately than any anxious early father. And I just really wanted us to see that what matters most is being found in Christ during this lifetime. And so, related to that, do we know the Father's heart for us? Do we know how much He is longing, what pains He has taken so that we might be found and reconciled to Him and brought back into His household to know His love for us? And as an overflow, do we share the Father's heart for those outside of faith in Christ? Because that certainly has to do with our mission. Our Christian mission, and that needs to be at the heart what drives and fuels our Christian mission. And so the prayer is, Lord, keep maturing me missionally. And I defined what it means to be on mission so that we could all be on the same page. I drew out these qualities purposely farming, spiritually farming Christ's kingdom on earth. For me, at least, one of the most helpful analogies to a lifelong marathon-like pursuit of Christian mission is to have the attitude of a farmer, just to faithfully plod along, to work through the seasons, to honor the seasons, to sow, to plow, etc., and to trust God through all the seasons to make things grow and for Him to provide the divine rains, so to speak. But certainly, our building of Christ's kingdom is meant to be done in and through the church, most practically to be part of a local church, in the biggest picture, wanting to see God's church in Jesus Christ to grow and to, if this world is going to change before Christ comes, that it would be because of the church's influence as we live out our faith in every area of life. And certainly the crux of our mission is to obey the Great Commission, to make disciples. That needs to be the focal point and the driving thrust of our mission, while motivated by the Great Commandment to respond to God's great love to us, and so to love Him as best as we can with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love our neighbor as Christ has loved us, using all our gifts that God has given us. At all times, this is meant to be a lifestyle in all places. So, even at our workplaces, to be asking the question, how can I be on mission here in the workplace and with all peoples? And so, the question that I asked to organize the sermon was, how do I nurture then a missional heart? And I leave that same question for your discussion time. And the first idea that I wanted you to see with me was to embrace the gospel's clear reason for mission. Go ahead and read Ephesians chapter 2, verses 17 to chapter 3, verse 1. And in regards to his mission to the Gentiles, Paul says, for this reason, So recall context, context, context. Look at the verses leading up to chapter 3, verse 1. What is Paul's reason to be on mission? Next question, have you taken the time to sort out why you witnessed to Christ? What is your reason? What has been your reason? To take a step back, do you indeed look for opportunities to witness to Jesus? Why or why not? And again, what is your reason? And so search and discern your motives. How can your reason to witness and be on mission mature to be more like Paul's? It's good to process, and I hope you're gathering there as a place of grace, and you can even process perhaps you've had ill motives in the past, and just to process that. Next, I wanted you to see with me that we should not be surprised at some cost to fulfill your mission, to follow Jesus and to be on mission. And so read chapter 3, verse 1 again, and Paul identifies himself as a prisoner for Christ Jesus. What does he mean, both literally and symbolically, by this phrase? And what does Paul's being a prisoner for Christ Jesus say about the inherent cost involved in being on mission? And what does costly discipleship look like today in 2021 in Toronto? Related, have you experienced a real emotional, social, financial cost to following Jesus? And if so, that stings at times. Even though Jesus is worth it, it stings. And so do you need encouragement? How can we pray for you so that you your weak knees are made strong and you can continue to walk and run with and for Christ? Well, next, I want you to see with me that we need to ask the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, for the Trinity's missional heart. And where I saw this was in reading verse 1 again of chapter 3, that Paul says he is on mission on behalf of you Gentiles, meaning he's been captured by the Father's heart for these outsiders. It's been revealed to him that Christ has died for these outsiders as well. And so what is Paul's intent behind that phrase, on behalf of you? What is he trying to communicate in particular with the phrase, on behalf of? And so to apply it to ourselves, who is your on behalf of person or persons? Who do you especially know and feel the Father's heart for? And how can we encourage you in your mission on behalf of that person or persons? And finally, I wanted you to see with me that we need to be on mission by faith. Everything in the Christian life is meant to be by faith, not by sight, but by faith, not by our own strength, in our own flesh, but by faith. And so read the rest of the passage, verses 2-6 of chapter 3. In these verses, we see Paul elaborating on what he is motivated by to be on mission. He elaborates. He gets into it more. So what is motivating Paul to stay the course? Hint, I drew out three things during the sermon. And so maybe you can recall what those three things were. And so as a follow-up, with a humble attitude, share with one another your disciplines to stay connected to the resources that Paul refers to. Okay, I want you to get really practical here, to really share practical, pragmatic, helpful tools and disciplines, but with a humble attitude, and humbly offer to one another things that work well for you. Okay. And then, on the flip side, gently, graciously, and caringly check in with one another about personal spiritual disciplines and how it's going. Because certainly our faith life is meant to be nurtured and sustained through grace-filled spiritual disciplines related to these things that I want you to discover and see as Paul was elaborating on what motivated him, these three things that I mentioned. Okay, so all in all, I hope that we would all continue to mature missionally, to continue to grow in an ability to live on mission for Christ, with Christ, because of Christ, for his kingdom, for the Father's glory. Have a wonderful time. God bless. Bye.